Morning to all of you. Dear friends, whether we are teaching face to face in traditional classroom, you can say lecture room, or whether we are following blended mode of imparting instruction, or we are following flipped instruction. So as a teacher, I want to know how much and how well my students have learned and what subsequent instruction should emphasize. Because on the basis of information I get about my student performance, I can incorporate certain changes in my lecture plan or when I, if I am following the blended mode of learning or flipped classroom. So today in this particular session, we are concerned with the measurement and evaluation of student performance. So measurement indicates how much, whereas evaluation is concerned with how much and how well. Okay. So now let me share my PPT. So in a classroom teaching learning process, we want to know how realistic are my teaching plans for the particular group of students. On the very first day, I have already told you that there are variety of learners sitting in the classroom. Some students learn best when only discussion takes place in the classroom. Some students learn best when something is shown to them. Okay. Some students learn best when they are engaged in certain activities. So, as a teacher, I want to know to what extent my teaching plan is realistic for the particular group of students. Likewise, how should students be grouped for more effective learning, or to what extent are the students ready for the next learning experience? So as a teacher, I want to know their prerequisites, okay, whether they possess prerequisites to begin with the new instruction, or are they ready for the new learning. So I want to know to what extent are the students attaining the minimum essentials of the course, or to what extent students are progressing beyond the minimum essentials. At what point would a review be most beneficial? That is, you see, you are taking the class, and the stage has now arrived, has now come. I want to make the review. Okay. Or what types of learning difficulties are the students encountering? Or which students are underachievers? Or which students should be referred to counseling, special classes, or remedial programs, and which students have poor self-understanding, and how effective was my teaching. So for this, we need to know measurement, assessment, scoring, test, and evaluation, because the teachers have been using these terms interchangeably, but actually the meaning is different. You see, measurement is concerned with the quantitative assessment of performance. For example, a measurement of student performance is 45 out of 50 correct mathematics problem. Okay, so this is the quantitative score. So this can be used to indicate a student's strengths and weaknesses. That is, the measurement answers the question how much, but we are not determining the worth. So measurement is the process of obtaining a numerical description of the degree to which an individual possesses a particular characteristics or a particular attribute, but it doesn't include the qualitative aspect, that is, whether his work was neat or not. Okay, now assessment is a process of gathering information for decision making on various issues related to the person who is being assessed. So, assessment involves the quantitative aspect also, that is the test scores when we are getting the test score, and the qualitative aspects to the anecdotal, or you can say records of the behavior, that is the non scholastic. So then comes scoring. You see, scoring is a procedure of assigning a numerical value to the assessment task, and where as the test connotes presentation of a standard set of questions to be answered. So a test, you can say it is an instrument, or it is a systematic procedure for measuring a sample of behavior. Test can be developed by teacher, or it can be developed by professional test developers, or these can be produced by the publishing companies. You have got the standardized test to measure the students' say learning style. So this test has been developed by some expert, and we are using to identify the learning styles of our students. So test, okay. So it is an instrument which is used to measure the performance, and the test provides as such an indication of a student's level of performance, that is how well does the individual perform, either in comparison with others or in comparison with the domain of learning outcomes. So test can be used for two types of testing. One is the norm reference testing, and second is the criterion reference testing. Then comes the evaluation. See, evaluation is much more comprehensive and inclusive than the concept of measurement, because evaluation involves judgment. So it is either quantitative or qualitative appraisal of performance, and includes the value judgment. That is, it is concerned with the desirability of the results. So evaluation is the process of determining the worth of something in relation to established benchmarks using assessment procedure. So basically, it is the process of providing information for numerous decision making. So it's a systematic process of determining the extent to which learning outcomes are achieved by the students. So evaluation, friends, can be done on individual student, it can be done on entire class, or you can also go for program evaluation, or the institute evaluation, or the state evaluation at the state level. Now let us now have a look at the purposes of the evaluation, why we need to evaluate our students, our curriculum, our you can say teaching methodology, the effectiveness of media, what for and why for. The evaluation provides as such some information regarding the extent to which a student has achieved mastery over a set of learning outcomes included in a course. So learning outcome, the concept is already you can say you are already familiar with the concept of learning outcome. It is a sentence or statement which describes what the learner will be able to do at the end of a unit of instruction. So you have enlisted number of learning outcomes. So after the class is over, you want to compare whether the students have achieved mastery over a set of learning outcomes or not. So evaluation provides information for comparative achievement of students in relation to learning outcome. That is, to what extent a student has attained the mastery of learning outcomes, and we are not comparing the student performance amongst themselves. So it also provides information to the teacher regarding the adequacy of method of instruction. Say, after delivering instruction through lecture method, and even during lecturing to come to know whether your students are attentive, you are looking at their faces, okay, you are asking some questions, you are not getting answers, it means your teaching method is not effective. So you need to change the methodology. Maybe you want to use multimedia and see whether the students are giving their attention or not, whether the students are motivated or not. So for this, evaluation is needed. So it provides information to the teacher for taking number of instructional decisions related to planning for teaching, grouping of students, or even diagnosing the learning difficulties, or even referring to some counseling and providing certain guidance. So information is needed. And evaluation also provide information to the student regarding the nature and level of his performance. Even this information is made available to the parents, and parents want to know to what extent their kids have achieved the mastery over the set of learning outcomes. So the information which you get through evaluation can be used for making certain administrative decisions such as placement or grouping or promotion of students, or for providing in-service training to the teacher, or even the facilities are not available. So it means we need to procure the facilities. Now let us come to the types of evaluation, because evaluation can be conducted during various phases in a teaching. And at the start is the placement evaluation. Here the role of the teacher is to place the students in programs appropriate to their interest and abilities. So as a teacher, before you begin with the new lecture, you want to know, does the student possess the knowledge and skills needed to begin the planned instruction? For example, the topic is, say, laws of inertia. So I want to know whether the students are familiar with the concept of rest, concept of motion, concept of force. Because once they have understood the concepts of rest, motion, and force, only then they will be able to understand the concept of inertia. So, to begin with, I'll ask few questions to know their level of prerequisites. So, say I can keep one object on it on the table and ask the students, what is the position of this object? Is it at rest or is it moving? Definitely, they will say that it is at rest. On switching on the fan, what is the position of this fan? They will say that it is in motion. So this object is at rest. How can I bring it into motion? Obviously, they will say that by pushing or by pulling, that is by applying some force, this object can be put into motion. So friends, say you are sitting in a moving bus and the driver suddenly applies brakes. What happens? They will say that, sir, we go forward. And what happens when the driver suddenly starts the bus? We go backward. So why are these due to? So the answer, because this is a new learning and you are going to introduce, so you will say that these are due to laws of inertia. So today in this session we will learn laws of inertia. So placement evaluation will help you to know at what stage you are going to introduce the new learning. So to what extent the student has already mastered the objectives of planned instruction, or to what extent do the student's interest, work habits, personality characteristics are different for different modes of instruction. So for this, a teacher can use the index of learning style for identifying their learning styles, the aptitude test, or say the prerequisite test on course objective, self-report on okay, and then you will make certain changes in your teaching plan to meet the different needs of your students. So this is the placement evaluation. Now we'll move to the second That is during the formation of learning. It is called
Hello.
Hello.
Sunil sir, can you
Sunil,
hear
that's
me?
certainly not able to hear you.
Hello, Amrit
Hello,
ma'am.
Amit ma'am, can you hear
Yes,
us?
ma'am. Hello. Okay, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am.
For sessional tests, or we are also providing them quizzes or assignments. So this is nothing but a kind of formative evaluation. Even during a class of 45 minutes, we ask number of questions during the conduct of the lecture. This is nothing but formative evaluation. So on the basis of its result, instruction can be modified to best meet the students' needs, and teacher can also review the content matter and his own presentation. He can also determine which portion of the lecture requires further elaboration or discussion. So this is formative evaluation. Then we have got the summative evaluation, and this tells whether and how much the students have learned. So this is a type of evaluation which is used at the end of a term or a course or the program. You see, summative evaluation can also be conducted at the lesson level. That is, after the topic is over, that is, at the end of the lecture, you are asking two, three questions pertaining to the lesson you have covered. So the answer to those questions will help you to know to what extent your students have learned. So the purpose is evaluating the progress, or the data you have got, you will use.
हेलो
हेलो
मनीषा, आई एम कॉलिंग बट दैट इज नॉट अटेंडिंग माय कॉल.
ओके
ओके
पार्टिसिपेंट्स
पार्टिसिपेंट्स नीरज सर विल गेट बैक टू यू ऑल.
आई होप
आई होप यू आर एबल टू हियर मी राइट नाउ.
Okay, thank
Okay, thank you so much. Please be patient.
you.
We'll resume the session soon.
Or you can also design an observation technique to diagnose the learning difficulty in the student, and students can then be referred to counseling or for remedial instruction accordingly.
Sir, sorry to interrupt you, but from the last 5 minutes, we were not able to hear your voice.
Huh?
From the last 5 minutes, after the formative evaluation, we were not able to hear your voice. You were not
Now is
audible to
it
us.
okay?
Yes, but the participants were not able to get
Even I am not getting your voice properly. So, from where should I begin with? Where
from
should I?
formative.
Huh?
Formative evaluation.
Formative evaluation. Okay.
Okay.
So friends, formative evaluation is concerned with monitoring of learning progress during instruction. When you are monitoring the student progress by asking fractional recapitulation or by asking few questions during the conduct of the lecture, you get information and you can make some changes in your lecture. Okay. So during a semester, we have 3 or 4 sessional tests. We also give them assignment, or we also give them some quizzes. Okay, so this is formative evaluation. Then the summative evaluation, and this evaluation tells whether and how much students have learned at the end of a unit of instruction or at the end of the semester, okay, or at the end of a year. So it is a type of evaluation used at the end. That is called, that is why it is called as summative evaluation. Okay, say during the lecture, you are taking a traditional classroom lecture, and at the end of the lecture, you ask 3-4 questions pertaining to the learning outcomes, and you get the information to what extent and how much students have learned in the lecture. So for this, criterion reference testing and norm reference testing can be used. Criterion reference testing is to compare the performance of student against the learning outcomes, and norm reference testing is to compare the performance of student performance of one student with the performance of another student. So that is norm reference testing. We also give them say project work, minor project or major project, workshop, field work or independent study. These are the part of the summative evaluation. And another type of evaluation which is equally important is the diagnostic evaluation. The purpose is to diagnose the persistent or recurring learning difficulties that are left unresolved during instruction by the standard corrective prescriptions of formative evaluation. The purpose is to formulate a plan for remedial action. So for this, you may use specially prepared diagnostic test and observational technique to obtain the students' persistent learning difficulties, and students can then be referred to counseling or the guidance, or they can be provided with remedial instruction. Now let us have a look at the evaluation process. So evaluation begins with formulating learning outcomes. So learning outcome, we have been telling you again and again, it is a sentence or statement which describes what the learner will be able to do at the unit of instruction. The topic is Ohm's law. For this, a number of learning outcomes can be stated. For example, define current, state SI unit of current, name the device which measure current, likewise for voltage and resistance. They will be able to draw the circuit diagram for verification of Ohm's law. They will be able to verify Ohm's law, or they will be able to draw a graph between V and I, or they will be able to list situations where Ohm's law can be applicable. So you have formulated number of learning outcomes, and please follow Bloom's taxonomy for using the specific action verbs for formulating learning outcome. Then also prepare for knowing the prerequisites, so pre-assessment, then developing appropriate learning experiences to the students, that is the lecture plan, and then devising and adopting suitable assessment procedure, and finally you will get the information and you will use that information for further decision making or incorporating some modification in your present way of teaching the students. So friends, evaluation can be viewed as a cyclical process including 4 phases. One is the preparation phase, second is the assessment phase, third is the evaluation phase, and fourth is the reflection phase. And the evaluation process involves the teacher as a decision maker throughout all the four phases. So in the preparation phase, decisions are made which describe the information needed, okay? Identification of what to evaluate, whether you want to evaluate knowledge, skills, and the attitude. The type of evaluation, whether it is at the beginning of the lecture or a semester, that is placement evaluation, whether it is during the lecture or during the semester, formative evaluation, whether it is at the end of the topic or end of the semester, that is summative evaluation, or the diagnostic to be used. And then you need to establish the criteria against which student learning outcomes will be judged. So this is the preparation phase, and the most appropriate assessment strategy with which to gather information on student progress you have to identify. So during this preparation phase, you want to know when and how to obtain needed information. The second phase is the assessment phase. So during the assessment phase, the teacher will identify information gathering strategies, or he can construct the tool, or he can select the instrument if these are available. He will then administer those instruments to the student and collect relevant information on student learning progress. So the this phase deals with determination of where, when, and how assessment will be conducted. Third phase is the evaluation phase. During the evaluation phase, the information gathered during the previous phase, that is the assessment phase, is used to make judgments about student progress. And based upon the judgments, decisions about teaching learning programs are then made and reported to the students, the parents, even the appropriate institution, HOD, head of the institution, number of personnel. This is the evaluation phase. And the fourth phase is the reflection phase, that will allow you to ponder the successes and shortfalls of the previous three phases. So specifically, you will evaluate the utility and appropriateness of the assessment strategies used and make decisions concerning improvements or modifications to subsequent teaching and assessment. So placement, formative, summative, and diagnostic evaluation processes each involve all the four phases. Now coming to the basic principles of evaluation, okay, then we'll proceed to techniques of evaluation. So basic principle is, firstly, you need to specify what you want to measure, what you want to evaluate. Purpose of evaluation must be clear to the teacher himself, because after knowing the purpose, then he will come to know whether he or she wants to evaluate the student performance in the cognitive domain, or his behavioral or his skill aspect, and what are the sources of learning outcomes, what are the different levels of learning outcomes. You know, the cognitive domain has got 6 levels, beginning with remembering, understanding, applying, analyzing, evaluating, and creating. Likewise, the psychomotor domain has got 5 levels, and affective domain has got 5 levels. And what are the teaching learning strategies? Whether you want to study the effectiveness of those teaching learning strategies, whether you want to study the effectiveness of instructional media. So it means you need to know what you want to evaluate first. Then what are the strategies or the models of evaluation available? So it means, as a teacher, you need to select an evaluation technique in terms of its relevance, because you cannot use only one technique of evaluation, because only one technique may have its certain advantages and limitations. So it will be incorrect to select only one type of assessment for measuring students' varied learning performance. So as a teacher, you need to use variety of techniques of evaluation. So that we will get to know after say 5 to 10 minutes. Then a comprehensive evaluation. Okay, you see, no single type of instrument can assess, as I just mentioned, no single type of instrument can assess the various levels of learning and various learning outcomes. For example, objective type tests are useful for measuring knowledge, understanding, application outcome, but for measuring higher than application, you need to use different other types of techniques. Essay types are used to measure the ability to organize and express ideas. Observation techniques can be used to assess performance skills and various aspects of student behavior. Likewise, self-report tests like attitude test, personality test, or learning style test, these can be used to evaluate students' interests, their abilities, their attitude, and etc. Therefore, a complete picture of student achievement and development requires combining the results of different techniques of assessment. So, comprehensive evaluation. Then, proper use of evaluation techniques requires an awareness of their limitations. Evaluation, as you see, techniques range from highly developed, that is the standardized test, to crude assessment device, that is the observational or self-report inventory. Okay, so they give results that are subject to various types of measurement error. For example, sampling error. See, achievement test may not adequately sample a particular domain of content. Chance factor, that is guessing on say objective type item, or subjective scoring in case of essay type items, or inconsistent responding on say self-report instrument. Therefore, you need to know the guidelines of preparing good quality test items, and you need to know how evaluation techniques can be used properly. Feedback plays a very important role in evaluation, because if you do not know, if you do not tell your students how they are performing, then how they can improve upon their performance. So you need to give them feedback, and in today's context, you see, you need to return their assignments or quizzes along with, you can say, conscientious remarks. That is, because we have seen that many a times, because of paucity of time, teachers simply write the remark on the assignment like checked, noted, or needs improvement. That is a global kind of or vague kind of you can say remarks are written on the assignment. So we never identify the you can say shortcomings in his assignment or the areas on which he or she has to more further develop it. So you have to give conscientious, you can say, rebounds. So feedback, and that too, feedback is to be provided immediately. Say you have asked one question in the classroom and student has rightly answered the question. Immediately say, wonderful Ramesh, you have said very rightly. Likewise, return the assignments within 1 or 2 days to the students. Another is continuous evaluation. There should be a component of internal evaluation, external evaluation, and most of the universities are giving 50% weightage to internal evaluation, 50% weightage to external evaluation. Internal evaluation may contain the components of sessional tests, quizzes in the class, assignments, or the presentation by the students, or the question answered by the students during the lecture, and so on. So likewise, different you can say techniques can be evolved for evaluating students' performance when you are following blended learning or when you are following flipped classroom. Now coming to methods of interpreting results. One is the criterion reference testing. So the purpose is to compare the performance of one learner against the learning outcomes. So that is why this describes student performance in terms of a clearly defined and delimited domain of learning tasks. Ohm's law, I have listed number of learning outcomes. So we are comparing the performance of one student against those learning outcomes. So student performance is assigned, is assessed against a set of predetermined standards, and it is based on a predetermined set of criteria. For example, 90% and up, you can say 80% to 89.99. But this criteria must be known to the students in the beginning of the semester. Okay, this is very important. So what are the pros and cons of criterion reference evaluation? It sets minimum performance expectations and demonstrate what students can and cannot do in relation to important content area standards. Where the different version is that sometimes it is very difficult to know just where to set boundary condition. So you have to set as per the ability level of your student. I want that the student should be able to answer 90% correctly. I don't want them to answer 100% correctly, because my students are average, okay, or maybe 80% criteria, and lack of comparative data with other student is another limitation in case of criteria reference testing. Another is norm reference testing, where purpose is to compare the performance of one student with the performance of another student, maybe in the same class or in the same institution or in the other institution under the same umbrella of technical university. So describe student performance in terms of relative position held in some known group. Interpretation can be based on a local, state or national group depending on the use to be made of the results. The student performance is assessed relative to the other students and based upon the assumption of standard norm, normal distribution with n more than 30, quotient, so employs the z-score, top 10% A grade, bottom 10% F grade, then next 20% to from the top is B, and so on. So you are following normal probability curve in order to grade these students. Norm reference testing ensures a spread between top and bottom of the class for clear grade setting and shows student performance relative to the group. On the other hand, in a group with greater performance, some will also be ensured an F. Whether he has got more than 50% mark, but he or she will get F definitely. Top and bottom performances can sometimes be very close, and norm reference testing also dispenses with absolute criteria for performance. And another is that being above average doesn't necessarily imply A performance. But because as per normal probability curve, you have to give them A. Few students have to be awarded A grade. Now coming to the characteristics of a good evaluation tool. Very important. So firstly, we'll talk about the validity. Validity, friend, is nothing but the appropriateness of the interpretation made from test scores or other evaluation results with regard to a particular use. For example, if a test is to be used to describe student achievement, then we should like to be able to interpret and score as a relevant and representative sample of the achievement domain to be measured. Another example, if the results are to be used as a measure of students' understanding first semester chemistry concepts, then we should like our interpretation to be based on evidence that the scores actually reflect understanding chemistry concepts and are not distorted by irrelevant factors. So basically, validity is always concerned with the specific use of the result and the soundness of our proposed interpretation. Okay, so validity means what a test measures, what it is supposed to measure. Let me give you one small illustration. Okay, the learning outcome is the student should be able to define force. Define force is the learning outcome. Now, if you give the corresponding question, what do you know by it, what do you know about force, or what is force? Okay, now these two questions are asking for different types of responses, whereas our learning outcome is define force. So it means in order to provide valid result, the corresponding question has to be define force and not what is force or what do you know about force. Because what do you know about force and what is force are measuring something different. Okay, so here we want to emphasize upon the content validity, which is the process of determining the extent to which a test provides a relevant and representative sample of the subject matter content. Now, what are the factors which lower the validity of, you see, your assessment results? Firstly, ambiguity in statements. For example, or unclear instructions. If I ask question like, what are Newton's laws of motion? Now, one person could only name the three laws. Another student could state each of the three laws. Another student could explain each of the three laws with one example. Another student try to give say two examples, because in examination halls all students know many things, but when it comes to delimiting the scope of the answer to be discussed, everybody applies his or her own mind. So can't the question like describe each of three Newton's laws of motion with one example? Now the instruction is quite clear, the statement is quite specific. You are not, say I ask, discuss about lubrication. Very global question. You have to be very specific. Only then you will get specific answers. So when there are ambiguity in statements, then definitely you will get different kinds of answers and the directions. For example, I asked, explain the working principle of carburetor of an IC engine. One student has described the working with the help of a sketch, and another student did not make any sketch. Can't you give instruction like, explain with a neat sketch the working principle of carburetor of an IC engine? So directions that do not clearly indicate to the student how to respond to the item tend to reduce the validity. Then the poorly constructed items or poorly arranged, that is improper arrangement of test item. So the items that unintendedly provide some clues to the answer will tend to measure the student along the question. those aspects of student performance that the test is intended to measure. Okay. Likewise, the items which are typically arranged in order of difficulty with the easiest item first. So if you place all the difficult items in the beginning, that will confuse the student who has not learned or who has not prepared or who has not prepared for the question, for the examination. Another is adopting, you see, definite response pattern. You have got 10 multiple choice questions. First answer is A, second is B, third is C, fourth is D, again fifth is A, sixth is B, and so on. So, or you have prepared number of true false items. First answer is 2, second is false, third is true, fourth is false. So, students tend to adopt a definite response pattern. Another is when the items you have included were not taught in the classroom, the vocabulary is very difficult. Say, elucidate the concept of. The students are not familiar with the term elucidate. So, what I suggest, my dear friends, to you that please pick up previous year's question paper and discuss those question paper on the last day of the semester, okay, or maybe in between also. And please make them aware about, make them familiarize about different terminologies which are used in a question paper, or or cheating by the participant. This is another, you can say, if it is not controlled, then definitely it will lower the validity of the results. Then we move to the another very important characteristics of a good evaluation tool is the reliability. Reliability is concerned with consistency of results from one measurement to another measurement. Okay. So, how consistent test scores or other evaluation results are from one measurement to another. Suppose, for example, Mr. Ashok had just given an achievement test to his students. Now, the first question is, how similar would the students' scores have been had he tested them yesterday or tomorrow or next week? Or how would the scores have varied had he tested a different sample of equivalent items? Or if it were an essay test, how much would the scores have differed had a different teacher scored it? So these are the types of questions with which reliability is concerned. So unless the measurement can be shown to be reasonably consistent over different occasions or over different samples of the same performance domain, we can have little confidence in the results. So we cannot expect test results to be to be perfectly consistent, because there are number of factors other than the quality being measured that may influence test scores. For example, if a single test is administered to the same group twice in close succession, then some variation in scores can be expected because of temporary fluctuations in the memory, attention, effort, fatigue, or guessing, and so on. And with a longer time between the test, additional variation in scores may be caused by various intervening learning experiences or changes in health, forgetting, and using less comparable testing conditions. So if we use a different sample of item in the second test, still another factor is likely to influence. So the results, and individual may find one test easier than the other because it happens to contain more items on topics with which they are familiar. So reliability, friends, refers to the results of obtained with an evaluation and not to the tool itself. So any particular test or tool may have a number of different reliabilities depending upon the group involved and the situation in which it is used. Therefore, it is more appropriate to talk of the reliability of the test score. And an estimate of reliability always refers to a particular type of consistency, because test scores are not reliable in general. They are reliable over different period of time, over different samples of questions, over different raters and like other factors. So for different interpretation, we need different analysis of consistency. So treating reliability as a general characteristic can only lead to number of interpretation. Friends, reliability is a necessary but not a sufficient condition for validity. So you see, a test produces totally inconsistent results. Cannot possibly provide valid information about the performance being measured. And on the other hand, highly consistent test results may be measuring something wrong or may be used in an inappropriate way. And reliability is primarily a statistical concept. So we used to compute coefficient of reliability in order to identify or in order to measure the degree of correlation. Now, what are the factors that affect the reliability, and if they are not taken into consideration, they will lower the reliability? The very first one is the length of the test. In general, the longer the test, the higher its reliability will be. That is, if a question paper contains 20 items instead of 8 items, where students are required to answer only 5 questions. So, the more the test is longer, the more you will get the reliable results. Because in case of attempting any 5 out of 8 questions, and each question carries 20 marks, and the questions are like, write a short note on, discuss something, what do you understand by something, and each of 20 marks. And if you have a longer test, say every question has 3 or 4 parts, maybe 4 parts, 5 marks each, so it means more content matter is being covered, and the scope of the answer is very much limited or specific, then definitely it will provide the reliable results. So the longer the test, the higher would be its reliability. This is because a longer test will provide a more adequate sample of the behavior being measured, and the scores are apt to be less distorted by chance factors like guessing. For example, to measure students' spelling ability, we ask student to spell one word. Now, there will be two situations. Either there are perfect spellers or there are complete failures. And if the word is difficult, most students would fail, and if the word is very easy, more students appear to be perfect. But the fact that one word provides an unreliable estimate of a student's spelling ability is quite obvious. So scores based on a large number of spelling words are more apt to reflect real differences in spelling ability, and therefore to be more stable. So by increasing the size of the sample of spelling behavior, we can measure the consistency of our measurement. Let me give you one more illustration. Say a longer test tends to reduce the influence of chance factors like guessing. For example, on a 10 item test which contains true and false, a student might know 7 of the items and he or she can guess at the other 3. A correct guess on incorrect guesses on all 3 items would result in only 7 points. So this would represent considerable variation in the test score resulting from the guessing alone. However, if the same student takes a test with 100 true and false items, the correct guesses would tend to be cancelled by incorrect guesses. Okay, so always go for a longer test. Then second one is the difficulty of test. See, items that are too easy or too difficult, these produce score of low reliability because such test results in a restricted spread of score. For example, for the easy test, scores are close together at the top end. That is, if the question paper is very easy, all the students will get marked like 88, 87, 86, 85, 84. And what is reliability? That is, if the one answer sheet is measured by two different teachers, the student who is getting 88 might get 88 only. But in this case, he may get 87 or 89 or 85, that is, he is not maintaining his or her relative position. But if the question is of adequate difficulty level, then this student's results would be 84, 79, 76, 74. So if the answer sheet is marked by two or more than two teachers, then the student would tend to retain his or her relative position. Objectivity of the test. What is objectivity? It is the degree to which equally competent scorers obtain the same results. So reliability of the objective test results, or reliability of the objective test results, is not affected by the scoring procedure. So in essay type test, the results depend to a large extent on the person or the teacher who is doing the scoring. So different score teachers would provide different results. Then another is the usability, ease of administration, time, ease of interpretation, cause. These are the minor, you can say, criteria which need to be considered while evaluating student performance. Now, friends, we'll move to the techniques of assessment, because each technique has its own advantages and disadvantages. So it will be incorrect to use a single technique of assessment for measuring students' varied learning abilities. So as a teacher, you need to use a variety of techniques of assessment in one semester. We'll begin with written test, closed book. That is where students are not required to carry some support material, closed book. Firstly, essay type, open-ended. Okay, when we say write a short note on this and this, describe the situations, okay, that demonstrate something, okay, situations, this is highly open-ended. So such questions impose no restriction on the students with respect to, say, the length or style of responses, and such type of test result, such type of test measure the student's ability to analyze, synthesize and evaluating. These also provide opportunity for expression. These encourage creativity, and you can also assess the argumentative skills. The disadvantage is that it is time consuming. There is subjective scoring. Because if I say, write a scientific evaluation of the Copernican theory of the solar system, include scientific observation that support your answer. Highly open, highly, you can say, vague question. So this will definitely favor the verbally fluent. So it will have low reliability, and moreover, you are asking only to attempt any 5 out of 8 questions, so limited content validity. Then written test, essay type, restricted response essay question. Example, describe the working of the carburetor of an IC engine, or describe any 2 situations that demonstrate the application of the law of conservation of energy. So it is, you see, in this kind of question, we are limiting both the content and the form of the student response. And the content is, you see, usually restricted by the scope of the topic to be answered, and limitations on the form of response are generally indicated in the statement of the question. When I say describe the working, or when I say state any 3 differences between covalent and electrovalent compound, any 3 differences between the sentence. Encourage good study habits. You see, essay type open-ended can be used as an assignment, but when it comes to the sessional test or end semester test, always try to include restricted response essay questions. The disadvantage, time consuming. Now another is short answer type. So under short answer type, we can include 2 types of item. One is the short answer question, and another is fill in the blanks question. So short answer question, like, in what year did man first land on the moon? Or state the relationship between molecular weight and vapor density. Or name 1 sulfide ore of copper. Or say 8 is what percentage of 64? It means small computation. The student has to construct the answer. So advantage is that you can test the comprehension ability. You can easily construct such type of question, and scoring is relatively more objective than the open-ended essay question, and this will help you to include more content in the question paper. Disadvantage is that you cannot use such questions for measuring higher mental abilities, like the analyzing, evaluating, creating. You can use up to some understanding. Application and higher than application cannot be measured through this one. Then written test, closed book, objective type. So true and false. So one statement is given and it is followed by the 2 options, yes or no, agree or disagree, true or false. And advantage is that you can cover more content matter, you can easily construct, scoring is objective, and test per unit working time is very less. Disadvantage is that guessing is there to some extent, and sometimes the incorrect items may produce some undesirable effect on the mind of the student. And if the items are not properly arranged, then student may adopt some definite response pattern. Another is matching type, where 2 columns are given, 2 tables are given. Students are required to match the items given in column 1 or table 1 with items or responses given in table 2 on certain basis. So basis of matching is also indicated in the statement of the question. Advantage is that these can be used where learning involves association of 2 things. You can easily construct, scoring is objective, guessing is minimum. So you can minimize the guessing if you include more number of responses than the items in the first column. So if you say there are 4 items in the the table 1 and 4 answers in table 2, then if the student knows 3 very well, then 4th he can opt very easily. But you need to increase the number of responses in table 2. Instead of keeping the same number, you can increase the number. Disadvantage is that limited applicability and overemphasis on simply memorization of facts, that is association of two things. Written test, closed book, multiple choice item. So these test a variety of abilities. You can go up to higher than application level. More content coverage is ensured. Objective scoring, guessing is minimum. If you introduce the concept of negative marking, and disadvantage is that sometimes these items are not easily constructed, because you know two answers, third answer you frame both A and B, fourth answer you frame neither A nor B, or if you have three answers you say all of the above or none of the above, and so it means you need to know the guidelines of writing multiple choice item. You have to ensure that the all the answers are plausible answers. Say there are four answers, these need to be plausible. Plausibility means that every answer has an equal probability of being selected by the student if he or she commits some error. So there is an answer, okay? So the answer should not be like odd man out. Another very important, and many universities, technical institutions, they are adopting this kind of test, open book written test, where students are allowed to carry three books or four books. And in one of the universities, I have come to know that they are allowing the student to carry two A4 size paper. They can write anything, any formula, anything on it, but only two A4 size pages will be allowed in the examination hall. But the construction of this kind of question is very difficult on the part of the teacher. There are number of advantages, that is you can test higher mental ability, that is you can go up to creating, develop good study habits, and it also reduces the worry and tension of memorizing formulas, equations and so on, because everything is available, made available. So disadvantage is that questions are difficult to construct, suitable only for higher ability groups. You may try with the final year students, okay? Maybe you may try with the sessional, you can begin with a sessional test, okay? Because in today's concept, when you are following blended learning or flipped instruction, so you need to use written tests which are open book based. Then another is skill test or performance test to measure the acquisition of skills in the laboratory, workshops, or you can say, and so on. So test to evaluate how quickly you can learn a new skill. Then oral questioning, which you normally use during lecture or after during the conduct of practical or in the laboratory. So it tests knowledge and oral communication skill, permits detailed probing by teacher, provide opportunity for clarification. Time consuming, because all the students cannot be asked all these questions, okay? So less reliable than written test. So and another is that it requires training on the part of teacher as far as questioning skill and how to probe. Observational techniques. One is the checklist. Observation technique can be used to measure student performance in the laboratory, workshops, okay? So you can prepare a checklist. Checklist will contain items to be marked by the reader, by the examiner or by the teacher. So one, you see one student is working in on some experiment, working on some experiment, and the teacher has prepared a checklist. Whether he has performed this, he will tick mark whether he has done this or not, so on. The checklist is basically a list of items required or points to think or the things needed to be done. So, advantage is that you can easily construct a checklist. Scoring is simple and you can use it for diagnosing the learning difficulties of the student. Disadvantage is that do not discriminate among students, because you are simply observing whether the item was present or absent. The quality is not being assessed, okay? And that can be done by the use of rating scale. So rating scale is a closed-ended survey question which is used to represent student feedback in a comparative form or comparative form for specific particular feature, product or services. You can go for graphic rating scale. Here you indicate the answer options on a scale of 1 to 3 or 1 to 5 or 1 to 7 and so on. For example, there will be a statement and there will be 5 responses against that statement. Express the level of satisfaction after attending to my demonstration. I have given the demonstration. So after the demonstration or after my lecture is over, please express your level of satisfaction by marking a tick or either on highly dissatisfied, dissatisfied, neutral, satisfied, highly satisfied. Numerical rating scale indicates the options on a scale of 1:3. So you can have finer discrimination with the help of rating scale, and you can identify strengths and weaknesses. The disadvantage is that there are chances of ambiguity in defining a trait. So you have constructed the rating scale. Please show it to your colleague. Ask for feedback whether a particular item measures particular trait or not, whether 3-point scale is needed, 5-point scale is needed. And another is that there is an error in scoring on account of halo effect. For example, I am rating 20 students in my practical class and one student is the son of my colleague. Obviously, I would like to give him full marks, whether he has performed it or not performed it. So better to have, you see, outside raters. And there is some kind of training to be provided to the evaluator while using rating scales. Another is self-report inventories or questionnaires, like the ones you have done on the very first day, that is index of self-learning style, or say personality test, interest inventory. Many tests are available. Advantage is that you can obtain information in the affected domain easily administered. Scoring is carried out easily, except in case of interview. Okay. Disadvantage is that you may get sometimes the fake data. Chance of a definite response pattern. Say there is a question like attitude of teachers towards teaching profession, and there are say 20 statements, and each statement will be measured on a 5-point scale: strongly agree, agree, neutral, disagree, strongly disagree. So I may use agree, 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 all these statements. Or I take the help of my colleague, please do me a favor and fill this one. So you will get the fake data unless you get it filled up in your presence. And in case you also have 50% negative statement and 50% positive statement, so then there will be no chance of a respondent taking mark on strongly agree. He or she has to read each and every statement. So aptitude test to assess a specific or general set of skills: numerical reasoning, verbal reasoning, diagrammatic reasoning, logical reasoning, inductive reasoning, error checking test you can construct. And we also have personality test or personality questionnaires. We also have leadership test, motivation test, situation. All these are self-report inventories or questionnaires which can be used to measure different behaviors. We have another very important test, sociometric technique, which can be used to form groups in the classroom. So if the group is large, you need to divide the group into smaller subgroups consisting of 10 members each, and the members of each group or subgroup may be numbered from 1 to 10. Say there are 10 students, You ask each member to write the name or the number of students with whom you like most to work or to play or to sit. Okay. Now, student number 7, number 2, number 10, number 5, number 6. This is the person who is like, because many of these people like to work with the person as the number 9. So advantage is that you can group students, then form group groups, and you can also use it for improving individual students' adjustment. Classroom is conducive to learning, then it is simple to use. Disadvantage is that time consuming, and sometimes some of the members may hide their real choices. So thank you, friends. Now the session is open, and if you have any query or you see any thing you want to add, you are welcome.
Then we had a question in the chat box by Ashwini sir. He says, any online tool to take subjective type online exam?
Any online tool to take subjective type online exam? Any online tool to take subjective type? You see, any online tool for constructing or for administering the question to the student? I did not understand your question. You see, the online tool which is already available, you can use it unless it is based upon this specific course material. Otherwise, it will lower its validity.
Sir, the next request is, can you please explain reflective phase?
So I have discussed the four phases. One is the preparation phase, the assessment phase, the evaluation phase. Fourth one is the reflective phase. So this phase allows the teacher to discuss about the successes and the shortcomings of the previous three phases, that is the preparation, assessment and the evaluation phase. That is, you have got the information. So you can make certain decisions concerning the improvement or modify, because you have got the information at the evaluation phase that the students have not got good marks. It means there is a need to discuss that particular topic again, or you need to make a different technique of delivering the instruction. That is the reflective phase, means that you are making certain decision based upon the information you have collected during the previous phase, that is the evaluation phase. How we take practical exam during using flipped class? Why not? You see, you have given them the instruction sheet, the procedure of carrying out the experimentation. They will study at home first, okay? Then in the classroom, they will actually perform. So the theory part, you have not discussed in the classroom. You have given them in the form of some instruction sheet or material or some video recording. In the classroom, they will actually perform the experimentation. So it will save the labor of giving the practical aspect of that practical work.
Sir, the next question is by Priya ma'am. Please, sir, say a few tips to engage the students effectively during the online classes.
Once, please repeat, Nisha ji.
Sir, few tips to engage the students effectively during the online classes.
I think many speakers have already described various techniques, tips for engaging students. So, you need not give the, you can say, a marathon type of lecture. You need to give small kind of type of questions during the lecture. Maybe Google form can be used. That is, say one aspect of the lecture has been completed, then you are giving some questions or some short answer questions where they are required to think over it. So this is how you can engage them, or you can give show them some video and ask them to observe something in that video. So they will be very much curious to know. जैसे अभी हमारे कुछ entertainment channels हैं, they say that we ask at the end two or three questions. So those who answer those questions correctly, they will be awarded with some prizes. So what the person wants or would do, he would try to listen to that particular video very attentively. Sociometric technique is useful for forming the groups, because many a times you have noticed that some students do not gel with other students. So you can make certain groups with the students who have got the like-minded, you can say, skills. It is fruitful, sir.
Sir, the next question is, what can be the best way to conduct Viva for 20 students online?
Viva.
Yes, sir.
Viva is, you please prepare a Google form, okay? Write the items on the Google form and give the Google form to them and ask them to, you see, that they will not switch off their video. So their video, the teacher can see them, how they are performing. I think this is the only way how you can conduct online Viva, because Google Form is the best suited.
Sir, Dr. P.M. Joshi raised his hand. Sir, I'll unmute you. You can ask your question now. Hello.
Sir, good morning. In fact, sir, I have put my question in chat box also. I want to ask whether we can have a direct sort of correlation between the technique of assessment and the cognitive skills as such.
Why not, sir? You have to do it, because as far as the NBA accreditation is concerned, you have to map the learning outcomes with the corresponding questions.
Correct. So whether you can suggest something, say for example, I want to test the creativity skill, this type of assessment technique I should prefer.
You can like ask that, design something.
If it is
that depends on the nature of this subject also, because many subjects do not demand for higher than mental ability. That is, you cannot go up to creating level. So correct. That depends. One is number the nature of the subject, and secondly, you can ask them to go for designing something, or say preparing something. That is, when you are giving them some minor projects or major projects, so that is the technique by which you can measure the creating aspect of cognitive domain.
Okay, okay, sir. Okay, thank you, sir.
So in case we have no more questions, so what we can do is, I close my session, and Mrs. Amandeep Kaur is already connected with us. So we have her session on design of rubrics, which is the extension of what I have covered in my session. So over to Amandeep ji.
Yes,